Stand with us. We're going to start with worship this morning.
Shaking, my heart's awakened. Our God is moving. Lord God, we are here today as your people. And God, we are desperate to know you, to be filled by you. Father, right now I just pray that all the distractions, all the brokenness and the things that this world throws at us, Lord, that those things would be put away. God, that today your spirit would just move in us and that we would just know what it means to walk in you, to just be with you, to have your presence in our life. Father, we just want to come before you today, lifting our hands out, crying out to you. Just acknowledging that we are in desperate, desperate need to have your sovereign power in our life. To be able to sit and just bask in your glory today, Lord. We just pray that your spirit would be amongst us, in us, and through us.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of love. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, in your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Yeah. tasted and seen of the sweetest of love. In my heart it comes free, and my shame is undone. Your presence, Holy Spirit, all welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is our heart's love.
Quiet your heart. And again, just to ask God to meet with you here today. Welcome to Church 180. We are glad you're here. My name is Jeremy. I'm a pastor here at the church. And we, again, are excited. I know lots is going on today. Most people are out at the lake or camping doing those things. But you've decided that you wanted to come here and worship with the body of Christ. And what an awesome thing to do. And couple of announcements and things that are going on here at the church. If you look in your bulletin, and I don't have one in front of me, so I'm going to mess up the date. Kids are dismissed to children's church. Missed that part. But baby dedication is right around the corner. And we have had a whole slew of babies in the last few. And somebody had their bulletin. Is it the 17th? Am I right? 17th. On the 17th, if you want to be a part of that, if you can just send an email to admin@church180.net, let us know. And if not, we'll try to remember who all's had babies and connect with you guys and make sure we've got all that in line. And then I know we've got a few others in November and some other and throughout the year. So anyway, just an awesome time to celebrate new life and just to pray for these families. And anyway, awesome thing to do. The other thing that we want to talk about. Wait, before we do, Jared, do you have anything you want to say about the new building?
Next week is getting a list of things that have to be done, and then what tools, if anybody wants to volunteer to help, they'll need. I've got a ton of tools, so I don't want to have like a bunch of saws and stuff lying around just tempting me. So if it's my saw, I'm tempted enough, take it home. If it's your saw, it will have my name on it. But, you know, hammers and stuff like that, you know, it's great. You guys have your own belt and stuff. So we'll be getting that list set up and ready to go. And whoever wants to volunteer on a certain part, we'll definitely be having some nighttime. Me and my crew will try some daytimes, but just with how short of span we have to go, it's going to be helpful with, just like how you guys have been doing demo days, to do framing days and insulation days. Joy.
And your visitor here, we're getting ready to move locations, and so we are under construction now just down the road where Don Gilberto is. Donnie G's. If you're from here, you know it's Donnie G's. But anyway, we're going to be down just down the way, and we're doing remodel right now, and we have to be done by November so that we can move into our new happy home. And anyway, if you are available in the coming weeks to help us build walls and do all that fun stuff, it is there's a lot of work ahead, so just make a note of that. Last thing we want to talk about is small groups. And so we've got a little video to kind of get that started.
So I'm Lori.
I'm Mark.
And we started coming to Church 180 about 4 years ago.
3 years ago.
And we had been coming for a couple years, and we just didn't feel connected to anybody in the church. And so they had announced that there was growth groups, and other people are doing what we're doing and gave our their testimony of the importance of growth groups. So we decided to join one, and
it's good.
It was good. I really liked how it's a safe setting. You can share your joys and your sorrows, and especially that we continue from the scriptures on Sunday and expound on them and get into more depth. And I'm real big about growing in my faith, and so that really helped me personally to grow in my faith.
It's good for the soul, it's good for relationships and communion and getting to know other people in your church. It's helped us out a lot.
So growth groups start back up September 24th. Thanks Mark and Lori for that. And yeah, there's such an incredible ministry in our church, and what an awesome thing. We met with our leaders last week, kind of getting everything fired up and ready for the new season. And so if you haven't signed up yet, I think we've got one almost every day of the week this year, which is a new thing. And so, was that? I thought I heard something. But anyway, awesome time to get together as a family. To get connected in a deeper way with people around the church, and then ultimately grow in your faith and pursue that. So I encourage you, starting September 24th, to be in a growth group. So that's all the announcements that I've got, but let's talk about prayer stuff. Is there anything that we need to be praying about today as a church? Ms. Mary Beth?
My brother was diagnosed a few weeks ago with throat cancer. He said it's a pretty curable one, it's not that big, but he's had surgery this Wednesday to remove a pretty big tumor on the side of his neck, just that everything would go well.
Yeah. Anybody else got anything? There's literally like a conga line of answers. I'll start from the back and go forward.
My husband Lou's having surgery on Wednesday. He's having a stent put in his aorta.
No. We pray for Mr. Lou for sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Lou's status. I just saw three hands all at once. Was it Sheldon?
I'm going to have an epidural in my back. Now I'm limping from my back and not my knee.
Gotcha.
So I have a friend whose daughter has mitochondrial disease, and she already lost a son mitochondrial, and now her daughter's been in the hospital 2 weeks, and they can't seem to control the pain.
Mm.
So just prayers.
Sure. Most definitely. Anybody else got anything?
I have a praise. So all the boys are at college. We got all kinds of kiddos there right now, and we're hearing back from everybody, and they're just blossoming. So
that's awesome.
Good things happen with those kids.
Yeah, and then your dad's got to head back. And
oh, and he'll try the whole way.
I know.
Oh, no, not for your driving.
You prayed for all these parents. Yeah.
I believe Dana and John and our church, they're traveling.
Yeah.
To New Mexico, and just for safe travels.
For sure. Yep. Okay, anything
about it? Nevada's traveling back and forth every day from Olathe to Grand Junction for college, so just for protection.
Yeah, okay. Sarah?
My friend, I'm sorry.
I know.
My friend died. He was on the Osprey crash in Australia. And he was a really dear friend. Could you please pray for his wife? Her name's Meredith, and we have three girls that are really young. They're like 7 and under. Would you pray for his family?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Okay, well, let's go. And again, if you were here last week, we started praying, but there was a plane crash in
Australia, and Sarah's friends were on board in the military. So we're just going to pray over that. Pray over all these things. And so, if you would, let's just take a moment, let's bow our heads, and let's just, again, you heard these things, and as the Spirit has just pricked certain things on your heart, take a moment and just pray over the things that you heard, and just lift these things up before a holy God, and I'll close this here in a moment. Lord God, we just come before you today knowing that you are the great healer. And Lord, I love that we can praise you, like Brittany was saying, for the good things, that we can lift up the boys and all those that are in college or working and traveling back and forth to school, all these things that were listed, and all these young kids that are starting to figure out life and move forward, and just the goodness that it is, the good thing that it is to get to watch them grow and move into this new era of life. And Lord, we want to just adore you today and give you all adoration and just point our hearts and our hands up towards you. And Father, at the same time, here in this moment, there's heaviness in this room, and you know that it's there, and you've heard these things before I even recall them. God, we do. We pray for our church family that's out traveling today with the holiday. We ask that you would just be with them in all ways, and that you would just protect them and look over them. But along with that, God, we just pray that you would be with Miss Mary Beth, with her brother. God, that all the cancer would be removed, that this would be a healing and a miracle that we could just attribute to you and praise you for in the coming days. Lord, we think of Mr. Lou, and as he prepares for surgery, we just ask that you would have him physically and spiritually ready for what's coming next. We pray that you would just look over him and that you would bring healing into his life. Father, we pray for Shauna and Callie's friend and all these that have just talked about the different ailments and things that are going on in their lives. Again, Lord, just knowing the brokenness that we face because of this thing that we call sin and the wretchedness and the awfulness that it puts into our life. And so we cry out to you as the God of hope to remedy these things. God, I just pray for the Wasangas right now. I pray for Sarah. She's just got such a heavy heart with the loss of a friend. And God, I pray that you would just, in the midst of everything and the hurt and the brokenness and just this awful situation, I pray that you would just redeem it. I pray that you would just be with a struggling wife and children as they're missing a father. And I pray that you would just blanket them in your presence and your peace this morning. God, I pray that you would just be with them and that you would just be in the midst of this situation in a radical way. Father, we just think about what's next in our church as we're moving forward, and we just ask that your spirit, again, would just guide us to every decision. Lord, that we would never get in the flesh. We would never pursue things that are not of you. And God, that just from the depths of our soul, our being, that we would just crave you and want to be with you and just cry out to connect with you in a deeper and deeper way. We love you, Father, and we just thank you for what it means to be yours. And Lord, as we go to your word today, I just pray that your truths would just penetrate our hearts and that we would just be able to celebrate you in an awesome way. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So over the last few weeks, we spent a few weeks in John chapter 3, and we were talking about just the idea of conversion. How do you get saved? You know, what happens at that moment when the light bulb comes on? And we started talking about the spiritual rebirth, being born again. In John chapter 3, John tells Nicodemus, you got to be born again, and that this act of new birth, that it comes from the Holy Spirit and from God above. Like, this is a supernatural thing that takes place in our lives. But what is it that happens when we're reborn? When we enter into new life, what is it that happens? I mean, is that where it really just begins and it ends? Is that the start and the finish to it all? Of course not. Like, we know, right? Like, there's something more to this. That's why we've gathered today on Sunday. That's why we've come together as a body, because there's something more here. The same Spirit that brought us into this new life also leads us through this new life. And when we think of our salvation, I think many times, you know, at least as the American church, we're guilty of thinking of our salvation as a moment. Again, there's a line in our Bible that we fill out, that we write in, and we put a date in there, and that's the day that I got saved. And that's what we link back to, and we keep going back to that moment. And the problem in that is that we link everything back to a moment, and we aren't living in it in the day-to-day. You see, it's not a moment. It may have begun in a moment, but it wasn't just about the moment. It wasn't just about, you know, just about being born again. It was about stepping into a new life after conversion occurred. When I was born again, I entered into this journey, this thing that we call salvation. Paul talks to the church in Philippi, and this is what he says. He says, hey, guys, therefore, my dear friends, just as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but even more in my absence. This is what he says. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. In other words, as I go through life, I'm processing through this thing called salvation. I'm working through this thing called salvation. I'm living in this thing that we call salvation. I'm working out God's salvation in my life. You see, while I know that I'm born again, I know that I was converted, I know that God did a work in my life, my salvation has not reached completion yet. It hasn't reached completion until I'm finally with Christ and I've received all that he has in store for me. I'm in the act of being saved. I'm in the act of living in my salvation. It started at my conversion, and it's leading me into my complete union with Christ. I'm living in this thing that we call salvation. I kind of think about it this way. You know, you imagine being lost out at sea, okay? And there's a big storm, and the waves are crashing, and they're just coming down on top of you. And, I mean, it's just beating you senseless. And then all of a sudden, there's a crack of lightning. And as that crack of lightning pops the sky, you see this boat, and you see the silhouette of a man. Lightning cracks again, and the next thing you know, there's a life preserver around you. And you can feel the tug, and you can feel yourself being brought into the boat. The thing is, you're not saved until you're in the boat, are you? You're in the act of salvation, but it's not complete until you're in the boat. As we walk through this life, at our conversion, it's as if Jesus has thrown a life preserver around us. And as we walk with the Spirit in our lives, we are led closer and closer to the day when everything is finally right, where the bondage of weight and sin are no more. You know, we talk about salvation, and this is not it yet. Because you can hear the brokenness in this room. We know that this isn't complete. We know that there's something better awaiting us. And so we're longing for that day. We're living for that day. My hope is not anchored into something that occurred at some point way back in my life. My hope is anchored to Christ, looking to Him, eyes on Him, longing for Him, awaiting the day when everything is truly safe and I can truly bask in the complete joy of my salvation. So what is it that draws us towards Christ? What is it that enables us to live our days as people who are living with the hope of salvation inside of us? I really believe it all comes down to having the Holy Spirit in our life. Active in our life. Learning to walk through life in the Spirit, it is an essential part of our spiritual life. And honestly, it's something we don't talk enough about. The Spirit took us from our hopeless state. The Holy Spirit of God took us from our hopeless state. And as we entered into this new life, we find that there is so much more. God is now with us. His Spirit is in us. Remember, several weeks ago, we talked about the dwelling place and how it had turned from being a temple, a place where you went, to the dwelling, a place of God, is now with man because of the Spirit. Our lives are changed, and we enter into the most incredible journey. In the ancient Celtic church, the Celtics had a really interesting term for the Holy Spirit. They didn't see the Holy Spirit as a dove ascending from heaven. Their terminology, their word for the word Holy Spirit, it was the word for a wild goose. That's how they explained the Holy Spirit. The meaning behind that peculiar choice is because they saw the Holy Spirit and how He had a tendency to disrupt and surprise us. The Holy Spirit moves in our lives in an unexpected fashion, similar to the actions of a wild goose. So from the ancient Celtic perspective, as followers of Christ, we find ourselves on this sort of spiritual wild goose chase, chasing after the Spirit of God, learning to go where He leads us, drawing closer to Him in the most intimate ways. Over the last few weeks, again, we talked about conversion in John chapter 3. And in that passage, Jesus talked about the work of the Holy Spirit. And in verse 8, He says this. He says, look, the wind blows where it pleases, and you hear its sound, but you don't know where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. And we talked about this. Our God moves in mysterious ways, ways that are sometimes beyond our comprehension. And as we learn to walk in the Spirit, we get to experience God. We get to experience Him doing some really radical, incredible things in our lives. This reality, it is constantly reflected in the lives of the saints. If you study through, you know, the church history, you just see person after person who's experienced this, who often, you know, they had their own ideas of where God was going and what it was going to take to follow God, but then God completely turned it all around. Francis of Assisi, for instance, he was one. He thought he heard God tell him to go rebuild his church. And so he took that quite literally. He went to a place called San Damiano, and there he started to build a broken down church. And in the midst of that, God spoke to his life and said, "No, that wasn't what I intended. I don't even care about four walls going back up." And he sent Francis of Assisi away to basically revolutionize the church, to change the philosophies and the theology and some of the things that were happening in the church. He was following God's call to gather bricks and to repair the church as it was falling apart. And instead, God did a spiritual work in him, and it would eventually change the world in radical ways. So for the next few weeks, we're going to be in Romans chapter 8. We're going to see how, we're going to look at what happens as the Holy Spirit guides us through this thing we call life. and leads us into the joys of our salvation. Here's my prayer. My prayer as we go through this for the next couple weeks is that we would just be willing to set out on this wild goose chase, if you will. That we would discover that it is not us ultimately that's chasing the wild goose, but rather the wild goose that's chasing after us. And that in this today, we're going to begin here in verses 1-4, and we're about to see something amazing that happens when we begin to walk through our life filled with the Holy Spirit. The scripture reads, and it says this. It says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus, because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, since it was weakened by the flesh, God did. He condemned sin in the flesh by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh as a sin offering, in order that the law's requirement would be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but who walk according to the Spirit. As Jesus' followers, we have been reborn. And this rebirth is leading us to walk no longer by our own pride or our own desires, but by God's Spirit being within us. Walking in the Spirit, it can be described as setting your heart to the leadings of the Holy Spirit. In this letter to Romans, Paul is very clear that the power of the Holy Spirit is this integral part of the gospel. As he travels around the world proclaiming it, he makes it known, you got to have this Spirit walking alongside you. The Spirit of God has to be within you, moving you, working in your life. According to Paul, look, we all have areas. We all have areas in which God is very pleased with us, and we've got those other areas where he's not, right? And Paul understood that it was only by living by the Spirit that we would ever overcome and we would ever see that change in our life that we so desperately need. It was only through the Spirit that we would be built up in those areas where we're weak, where you know, we would think, man, there's no hope I'm ever going to change. Gradually, by walking with the Spirit, those things that were displeasing to God, those things that were sinful, we do away with them. Paul's so realistic about this. And he knows how challenging this can be. In one of the most famous passages in Romans, in chapter 7, he says, look, I don't understand. I don't get it. I don't understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want. I don't do those things that I know are God that are going to make you happy. Instead, I do the very thing that I hate. The thing that I know I shouldn't do, and doggone it, I keep on doing it. Doesn't that sound, that experience, doesn't that sound a lot like your own dilemma? I mean, I'm reading that and I'm thinking, Paul, I get that so well. You know, I do my best, I feel good, I do it for a while, and then just right down the drain. It's awful. Each one of us, we have our own forms of erratic behavior. And you think about that. In one on your own. And it's such an incredible thing to live in. Here's the thing. Everything this morning, it comes down to verse 4. In verse 4, it says this. In order that the law's requirement, think about that word for a second, requirement. In order that the law's requirement, Jesus did all of this work in us. He defeated sin and death when we couldn't. In order that the law's requirement would be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. What God did through the work of Christ and through the Holy Spirit in our lives, it met the law's requirement. Now think on that for a moment, okay? What was the requirement of the Old Testament law? What? I saw lips move. Help me out. A whole lot of crap. Okay. Was that? A lot of blood? Yeah. Perfection? Yeah. Nothing's wrong. But I think it comes down to one main word, and that's righteousness. Righteousness. You see, you look at God's plan, and you look at how he works, and the thing that God wanted us to try and accomplish by living out the law was a sense of righteousness. That's a church word, and we use it, and sometimes we might be able to define it, but do we really live by it? Is it a concept in our lives? What is righteousness? Well, God set up a system that could lead men to righteousness. The problem was that man just couldn't do it on their own because we were broken. And you process that, and you sort of think about that. And what is righteousness? It's the quality of being right in the eyes of God. That means my mind, my nature, my obedience, my conscience. I mean, everything about me, my entire existence is to be in right standing with God. It's meeting God's standard. Being righteous sets you apart. It makes you distinct. It makes you holy. And so righteousness, it's the requirement. And this makes perfect sense when you consider that in the beginning, we were created in the image of God. We were created in the image of God in the beginning. That means we were created righteous. And because we were righteous and we were in his image, we were able to commune and we were able to connect with God in the most intimate of ways. We knew him, and he knew us, and we were with him, and he was with us. We existed in perfect peace, in freedom, in joy. But when sin entered the picture, our righteousness left us. We were no longer bearers of the image of God. We were condemned. God hated what happened. He hated the curse and the condemnation that was put upon us as his precious creation. And so he did for us what we could not do for ourselves. He paid the price so that we might be able to be seen as righteous again. As we come into belief, as we begin this new life, we begin to live again in a state of righteousness. Not of our own, that's self-righteousness, but his righteousness. And all of the promises of righteousness, they all become ours again. Now think about what that means. Let's travel through the scriptures, and there's a whole lot more than I can even touch today. But you think about this. Here's the first thing. Righteousness, it's a gift from God. It's a gift from God. In Romans chapter 3, it says, the righteousness of God is through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. Since there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, they are justified freely by his grace through redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Receiving the gift of righteousness allows you to enjoy fellowship with God. Next thing, righteousness separates you from religious traditions and the traditions of men. In Romans 14, it says, for the kingdom of God is not eating or drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Religion focuses on all the do's and don'ts. The word says that the kingdom of God is not for food and drink, but righteousness. Receiving righteousness, it allows you to enjoy being fully accepted by God. Not because of what you do, but because of what he did. Righteousness protects you against the enemy's most potent weapon. In Romans 8, it says, therefore, again, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The enemy wants to condemn you, wants to keep that before you all the time, wants to let you know that, you know,
you live your life as a condemned person. You're never good enough. Your past always comes back to creep up on you. But righteousness says, no, it's not, because Jesus has covered it. We get to live in that. Our past can't haunt us because Christ's righteousness has taken over. Righteousness nurtures the development of your faith. In Hebrews 10, it says, but my righteous one will live by faith, and if he draws back, I'll have no pleasure in him. You know, the scripture teaches that just by receiving righteousness, by living in this and growing in this, it teaches you more and more about God. It connects you deeper and deeper in your faith. It nurtures you. Righteousness gives you boldness to speak out about your faith. In Romans 10, it says, the message is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. This is the message of faith that we proclaim. We make it known. By having righteousness in our lives, it makes us able to speak. You know, otherwise, I'm just talking in my flesh. But God's righteousness, his spirit within me, it enables me to actually communicate his truth to others. Righteousness connects you to the blessings of God in Matthew 6. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be provided for you. Receiving righteousness allows you to enjoy living an abundant life. Abundant life meaning that your body, your mind, your spirit, you are completely connected to Christ. It shows you how to enjoy the life that Jesus died to give you. It makes you complete. And so now, church, here we are. The born again, blanketed in righteousness, the righteousness of Christ, given to us through the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We are now living in righteousness. And the goal is to get to dive into the depths of that righteousness. Don't just stay there in the shallow end. You can't really, a toddler can have fun in the shallow end, but that's no fun for big people. Dive in deep. Learn what it means to dive in deep to the righteousness of God through the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Communion with God is restored. This is what happens. This is how God brings his plan back around full circle. Through righteousness and through the Spirit's work in our lives, this is how we begin to know him, how we grow in him. We can, again, pursue all of those things that set us apart in the beginning. We can pursue all these things that made life so great in the first place, in the beginning, and we can pursue it. Here's the thing. The wild goose is chasing after us. And he's pushing us into this thing that we call righteousness. He's daily changing our lives. And he's doing so many unexpected, amazing things, all intended to draw us closer to God himself. That's what he wants. The wild goose has been chasing after you. And at a certain point in your life, I'm just praying that you begin to pursue after him. That's a part of your life now, and that you're living in that. Living for something greater than self. Living for the purposes that you were originally intended for, knowing God in an intimate way. To know God, to pursue him, believing that he is the source of all that is good and right. I love what John Piper says about that. He says that God is most glorified when I'm most satisfied in him. What an awesome concept. The deeper I am, the more entrenched I am with God, the more I'm going to live to glorify him. Because my life's different, because everything's changed. You know, I really believe as we begin these next 5 weeks that, if we'll allow it, we can set off on an awfully big adventure here. Because if we'll allow God to start to do work in our lives in the radical way that he intends, knowing that he's been chasing after us for a long time. Man, I just wonder what could happen if righteousness became our goal. Pursuing after him, moving towards him, learning to walk in the Spirit. Listen, I just believe it's the most exciting of ways to live your life. And I think it's so exciting that it's worth spending some time diving into. I really believe that that mercy and healing and peace and the presence of God, all of these things are right here at our footstep. If we just learn to embrace it. I'm going to ask all the musicians to come back up, and we're going to close with a song. And as we sing, the altar's open if you want to spend time in prayer. And above all, we just want to take time just in a moment of surrender. And here's what I'm going to ask, if you would, as they start to play, take a moment and just consider what we talked about this morning. I know we say a lot of things about the Holy Spirit's work, and denominations take that all over the place. But here's the thing. The Spirit of God is real, it is active, and he is alive inside of each one of us who call ourselves a believer, a follower of Jesus Christ. And so as we begin this series and we start to think about just the implications of the Spirit's work in our life, would you just take a moment and simply just surrender your heart? If there is pride that's in the way, if there are things that are keeping you from truly embracing the movement of Christ, the work of Christ, the movement of the Spirit in your life, would you just take the quiet of this moment? It's almost a moment of rededication. And if you're here today and really from the depths of your heart, you feel like there is a pursuit and you know that you're chasing after God and you just want more of him and you want to taste more of him, then here in this moment, would you just again come before a holy God, just praising him, giving him glory here in this moment. Our God loves us in the most amazing of ways. And to learn to fellowship with him, to learn to connect with him, to learn to be intimate with and just close to him. There is nothing better than that. As we continue to worship, just encourage you to allow God's Spirit to move and work in you. Yeah. as we leave here, it's knowing that you have a God that loves you and that wants to wrap you in his righteousness. Father, we love you. We just thank you for what it means to be yours and to be here today as your people. God, as we leave this place, it is just knowing that it is an amazing thing to be full of you. Let us live our lives glorifying you as you fill us with your presence. We love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thanks for being here today.